All right, yeah, what's good? It's your boy, No Name. Coming in with a quick hitter. There was a patch yesterday. I wanted to get this out yesterday, but I was busy, so I didn't really have time to, or things to do. You get what I mean. But, like, I wanted to get out a quick hitter about this patch notes that just hit us with this week, June 27th, as you see here on the screen, version 1. This is a pretty large patch. And I just want to say real quick, I think it's crazy that they did this without, like, a server, without, like, bringing server downtime. At all across 2 days, they just did live maintenance and then just had it be one of those things where you just needed to like very quickly restart to actually receive patch. And I think that's ridiculous, just like industry standard wise. I'm just so unused to that being a thing, right? So, all right, so let's talk about the actual patch real quick. There's a couple things in here that I just thought were really super noteworthy. I'm not going to go through the whole of every single thing in here because I think it's for you to do, and I'll have the link in the description so you can do that. But couple things that I just thought were really worth noting talking about here. One, face an issue where the level 100 pinnacle boss would appear again with no health bar killed during a specific phase. If you know who the boss is, you know, I'm not going to spoil it, but if you've seen like Ben's kills, for example, Ben's kills were the first kills I saw, and I used to think that she just didn't have a health bar in that phase, like a proper boss health bar. And I was like, how the fuck are you supposed to keep track of her stagger? And it wasn't until Northwar's kill on the Blizzard Strike where he just absolutely deleted the ball that I found out that there was actually supposed to be a health bar in P2. So glad that got fixed. There's a couple other good fixes in here and stuff, but like this is like the big one that I just thought was pretty funny. Handful of gameplay fixes in here. None of these are super prominent to anything that I do, except this one amused me when I would see it, the upright spider hosts, as well as I'm glad to see that burning instincts legendary note is getting a little bit of extra strength back just because it's getting a bug fix. Nothing ridiculous there. I just was glad to see that it was getting fixed. Other than that, a handful of other things you can see here, you know, Mantrill, which is a specialization quest for rogues. I'm glad to see that this is like, you know, fully working again. Whole lot of UI stuff, which unfortunately the UI stuff in here does not include the search bar. Come on, Blizz, I need you to get us that search bar, bro. That's like the only thing I actually give a damn about from here. A whole lot of stuff in here. Like, this is a really large patch. If you're having some issues with playing the game, laptop with certain dedicated GPUs, this might have actually fixed your problem. This patch actually didn't fix any of my issues I was having with the game, but I found out it's just I had to change some settings around because of VRAM issues. Kind of brutal, though. Then, here we are, the meat and potato. This section right here, experience rewards, chef's kiss. Significantly increase the experience rewarded for completing Nightmare Dungeons, significantly increase the experience gained from killing monsters in the Nightmare Dungeons. Helltide chest now provides substantially more bonus XP when opened. Significantly increased reward XP from completing individual whispers across the board, and fixed the issue where there's no experience for completing the intermission events that happen during dungeons. So these are all massive changes to the game. The first two buffing Nightmare Dungeons into the loop, and I'm gonna like very quickly just flash on screen what it looks like on my character now, or like look at my character. My Slurk is level 91. I started the session earlier today at about 91 or 81, my bad. I put up about 10 levels in about 10 hours, and it was strictly doing Nightmare. Like, I was literally just like, man, I finally need to level my glyphs. I had like 2 or 3 15s and a lot of other poverty stuff going on here, and now I have a 21 and everything else is 15 except for it doesn't need to be yet. That was a huge change, huge quality of life, huge overall gameplay feel improvement. This is incredible. Just for some stuff to give you an idea of scope, end of dungeon rewards were in the sub 40k range, like sub 40k for completing the full Nightmare Dungeon, and even just the reward for completing like a 33 was about 169k. I think that was right. I can't remember the tier correctly, but just like think about, that's just the completion, and the XP is so much better. In the earlier stages of doing it, I was getting almost a full Paragon point per, or not over, about like 17 to 20% of a level per dungeon, This kind of fluctuated depending on the dungeon, but the overall like implication of the change in fucking incredible. What this really just means is that now spamming nightmare dungeons in order to level your glyphs and your character is extremely efficient for gaining XP. You're still going to need to do Helltides, which Helltides also got an XP, which the XP from chest, by the way, scales with the cost of the chest. Chest like protections that give cinder armor give less XP than mysteries at 105 cinders. So you still get rewarded very heavily for playing around the mysteries. And Helltide is still going to be a super critical part of the end game, as you know, especially now that you're gearing, you're leveling better, glyphs are being leveled. You're going to need actual gear to craft on, and the Helltide is going to provide, you know, your ability to craft those with Forgotten Souls. So overall, the end game loop got strengthened a lot in terms of its relative value in the XP cycle. But I want to give a special shout out to this first change. So past couple days, I started leveling. I have a rogue that I leveled very quickly, and I did the leveling of my rogue actually mostly through whispers before this patch, right? And if I already thought it was fairly competitive, like solo farming a dungeon, just because it's pretty difficult, so you don't have like that type of density. Like Fine Burrows, for example, pretty well known as the best of our dungeon of our solo farmer dungeons at the moment. Not an incredible dungeon in T1 just because of the lack of density. You got a lot of value out of whisper bonuses, whispers themselves, and the tree giving a massive chunk at the end. And now with the significant increase from the actual whispers themselves, leveling all through whispers, it through whispers and gathering is just a perfect, like, perfect utilization of the system. I am so happy about this change. Overall, absolute hit right on the noggin from experience changes. Other related changes is that Kixarf, the roaming Helltide boss, actually will give better loot. I haven't tested this one yet personally. I haven't run any Helltides since. I'll be running Helltides tomorrow because I realized I'm kind of low on resources. That like burning through everything, blasting. And here's the other thing, because this isn't included in the XP section, but it should be. Teleporting to the Nightmare Dungeon map. I'm not gonna do it right now on stream on camera just because I don't really want to. I don't think I have any sigils I'm willing to waste. Actually, that's a lie. I did get one. I got this 22 that I don't care. But so check it out. I activate the sigil. Now it's on my map and it's right. Now you can left click it and travel there. And I'm in it. And then boom, and this load screen ends. I'll be right outside the entrance to the dungeon. I can enter, do my sigil, and this cycle from anywhere. You can teleport no matter if you're in the dungeon, if you're right here, overall, no matter where you are, teleport to the next one, which dramatically changes the efficiency of leveling through nightmare dungeons and is a large part of what made this work so well today. When I was running with a friend or two, we were just boom 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 boom. I said it to my friend actually when we were playing, it reminds me of running Greater Rifts again in D3. Like, there's all these other cool overworld functions, and, you know, there's Helltides and whispers and whatnot for everything else. But at the end of the day, sometimes I just want to sit and grind, and Nightmare Dungeons finally fill that sit and grind role. So I'm very, very happy to see that. That was probably the biggest change that really brought me back into the fold. As a result of this, by the way, because of the XP buffs and as well as this change about travel, some point, maybe this week, I'm going to probably construct a tier list of dungeons that I recommend, just because there's a lot of data about Nightmare Dungeon farming currently out there, but a lot of that data from what we were looking at when we were playing right after the patch is very clearly predicated off of the travel time, or includes the travel time needed to get to the dungeon as a part of the talking point. You have dungeons like Dark Ravine, actually a pretty decent solo dungeon, just in terms of the way that the map progresses as you move through it and the density it provides. But it's a really bad dungeon because, at least before this patch, because of the travel time. And that travel time is no longer a factor, right? And so there's some reevaluation to be done on a lot of these dungeons because of this fact. So hopefully I can get something out that, or at least have some knowledge. At the very least, come check it out in the Discord. Link will be in the description down below. I'll talk about it there at the very least. You can ask me some questions or check me out on Twitch. Link will also be in the description. I'm live on, but live at night, but not on Wednesday and not on Sundays. Then, you know, I do raid on Fridays and Saturdays, so there's a little bit of like there, but even then you could ask me D4 related questions and I've got answers. The multi-game session doesn't really affect that, right? So anyways, other couple things in here that were relevant. There's like two things that I want to mention, maybe three. World Balls Casters are no longer locked to level 80. Thank the Lord, that was such a dumb change. There are a lot of, then there's some death notes that I think are worth talking about, right? Density as an upcoming part of changes for season one or early season one. Good. There are some dungeons that still need some density updates. Helltide definitely could use a small density increase, specifically, like the Shod Helltide or the Fractured Peaks Helltide, my bad. It could definitely use some density increasing. So I would like to see what that's going to look like. As well, there were just some dungeons where I was running. I was like, where are the monsters at? Where's the XP? Where's the loot? Other than that, other things in here, the balance notes, I'm not really going to talk a whole lot about what's in the balance changes in particular. Game that sounds are messing with me needs to be. And a lot of these balance changes are insignificant. Not insignificant, but they're not like game changing. There's like a couple I'm gonna point out, but most of these changes aren't game changing. But it's a lot of changes on basic skills to make the basic skills actually feel better. So the ones that don't already feel good, right? Arc Lash players, sit back down. I know, I feel you, bro. I was hoping for a buff too, but for the ones that are used primarily as generators or in the leveling experience, got some love. So that's a good thing. The other thing that I wanted to note here, there's a lot of skills that got somewhere between 10 and 15% buffs just to like try to make them more competitive. So, you know, if you had a skill that you wanted to mess around with, but it wasn't particularly viable before, maybe give it a whirl now. It might be actually viable now, right? So give it another shot. And the one that I'm actually more important about, in the future updates, they're looking at minion survivability and build parity. Build parity is fancy wording for the fact that there are some builds that are really overtuned, right? We talk about like Hoda Barb looks pretty over up there. You know, TB Rogue is definitely a good cut above most other rogue builds. Stormclaw Druid is insane. Wear Nano Druid, right? Bone Spear Necros are extremely strong. Like, there's some handful of builds that are really strong. So build parity is kind of their Blizzard's fancy wording for we're gonna nerf some stuff, which every developer has. I'm just here to point it out to you. The one I'm more interested in is minion survivability. If you watched my what's issue with the necromancers video, I got the link so you can hear what my complaints. One of my biggest points in that video is just literally that the minions don't live. Even with decent investment, and this is just talking about leveling, right? Because I wasn't even at the Paragon point in the game when I had started to have these issues where the minions just were non-living. I had nodes on a tree. I had an aspect dedicated to that. Like, it was really dumb how much it took to make them live. So I do hope that these future updates, minion survivability, will actually make them playable. And this is not just a necro problem. I've heard this is also kind of a druid problem as well with its companions. So, you know, do it for both of them, right? Other than that, a lot of changes by class. Something to note if you're reading through this on your own is that Barb is the only class with this note about flat damage aspects. This is stupid. This should have been a top level dev note. Anyways, a lot of changes here that like some of them I don't understand because I haven't played the class yet, or just like looking at them, they didn't seem too major. Right. Oh man. Decompose went from 30 to 33%. That's a 10% damage increase. Okay, cool. Like, a lot of the changes can be described that way. A couple things that really stood out to me, either from my build concepts or just things that looked like they were, like, didn't need this much. Number one on that list is Hurricane. I was already planning on leveling a druid, but after seeing Hurricane get a like 50% damage buff, I will be making a druid, and I already kind of wanted to play around Hurricane as it was going to be Hurricane or Tornado. Now with 50% buff to Hurricane, I am going to do something with Hurricane. Like, so if you know, if you're interested in Hurricane, I recommend checking this out as well. There's also buffs like Rabies and stuff, but you know, the Hurricane one was really the one that stood out to me there. Necromancers, there's some love in here that doesn't really affect my build all that much, but the build that I said I would turn my Necro into if I ever committed to leveling it and gearing and thinking about gearing it proper is that I said I wanted to turn it into a Blood Wave build, and there were multiple changes in here that really like helped make that real. Rathma's Vigor got a 20% increase in its uptime, realistically, is what that, right? Or 25%, my bad. Every minute you get 5 procs instead of 4 procs with Force Overpower. This is incredible for Blood Wave setups. And with Fast Blood getting increased from a min 1 to max 1.5, you now require even less Blood Orbs to actually get your Blood Wave to be within this cooldown threshold for Rathma's Vigor. So I think this combo could be actually really good, and I'm glad to see that the uptime on it is now being like addressed in a way. Could be a cool idea to play with. Still not sure how it's gonna, like, you know, the numbers don't really, who knows. And there was, I think that was all I saw, you know, like the rogue changes or rogue changes, nothing really special there. Sword changes or sword changes. There's a couple things. There was like one thing that got me like moderately excited when I looked in here. One, if anyone knows what Freezing Wake is, please tell me. I spent a good amount of time trying to figure out what the hell Freezing Wake is. Two, can't believe they bluffed Blizzard. Not after what I saw in that North War video. If you haven't seen the North War video, you should watch it. And three, when I started out looking at stuff for things to do with Sork after leveling it, right? Because I figured this wouldn't work in leveling. I wanted to play around Crackling Energy. Because Crackling Energy just allows you to run around and do damage. I thought that was a really cool idea. Crackling Energy just got a 33% damage buff. That's not all, though. 30% damage buff to Crackling Energy. Lightning Spear, from its upgrade, now can collect an additional 60% damage, which works out to about a 30% buff for this aspect, or for this upgrade. This is pretty good, because it's really easy to collect 8 Crackling Energies to get that extra damage instead of 5. Additionally, so Abundant Energy is pretty cool. This is like a clear speed buff for CE, but the big things that I saw in here were the Lightning Sphere buff and the buff to actual CE itself. This opens up some more possibilities for me to actually like make that build work. Relatedly, if you're interested in Swipe builds that are kind of cool and not currently being played, Charge Bolts also got a really good buff. Charge Bolt itself got a small quick buff, like about 10%, maybe less than it, if we like maybe like closer to like 9%, 8-9%. Very good, very nice, solid buff. But it also had its legendary, or its unique, my bad, buffed. Just going from 30% DR to 25% DR is a pretty decent deal in terms of its damage output. That's about another 8% recouped in damage being given back to it. And so, being between Staff of Lamescence buff, as well as the actual buff to Charge Bolts, there's actually probably something there in some form. It's just not something I'll be like, you know, I'll be exploring myself, and at least yet, right? I have other fish to fry. But like, you know, there's probably some other stuff in like the barb section, or not, that's actually worth looking at for making something new out of. So I recommend you check out the patch notes yourself to get the rest of the details. And this is supposed to be a quick hitter, but there's just a lot of going on even in the stuff that I talked about briefly, which is why I didn't want to go over the whole patch notes. Because there's a lot in here, you know, scrolled through, especially like the quests or the UI section, and see if there's any issues that you cared about that were hit in here. Let me know in the comments if anything important from these patch notes you feel like I missed, and I should definitely make sure I address in the future. But overall, this has been me. Thank you for watching the video. You know, if you liked it, leave a like. You know, if you give me a subscribe, I'll kiss you. Check me out on Twitch, you know, when I'm live. And you know, I come back on the Discord. I guess, right? come check us out. We're trying to build something special here, you know, get a community of gamers. Also, you know, if you want to run content with us, I mean, hey, look, you come hang out, we run content with you, right? You get the feel. You get the feel. Anyways, I wanted this to be a quick hitter, and it's already a little bit longer than I actually intended it to be, so I got to get up out of here. But, you know, happy patch, bro. This is a great patch. Enjoy the game. I've hopefully got some more stuff coming around, including at some point a push for this video for season one. Just because now that I've seen what they can do in a macro patch, I want to talk about some stuff that I want to see from a macro patch, right? Anyways, peace out. Thank you for watching. Take care.